with you. Good to see you. And very good to be here in Liverpool, which is my home city. That's where I was brought up as a kid, at least for a few years before moving away to the south, really. So I always feel it's nice to be back in the proper pretty north, really. I have a very vivid memory of my grandfather who lived in Crosby, which I know is not proper Liverpool, but that's not there. And I was always curious about his accent when I was a child, because you know how Scouse people speak sometimes, with their teeth gritted, slightly from the back of their throat, really. You know, are you all right, pal? Are you all right, pal? Okay, translating in the south. And I said to him one day, you know, why do you speak with your teeth gritted like that, Grandad? And he said, because they'll lick your fillings. So, proper Scouse humour. I'm, of course, an Everton fan, which is a little bit like being an Anglican. It's just a life of eternal disappointment. We look back on our glory days, which we can barely remember, and remember how it was, how it might be. Probably not. Anyway, there we are. It's a great delight to be here, and thank you very much to Miranda for bringing all of this together and the modern church as well. And I'm figuring that the interest in this conference tells us already a great deal about the subject and the levels of interest and anxiety around the subject of evangelism. There was a conference years ago, actually, by John Saxby, and the book of the same name on liberal evangelism, and I'm not really going to talk about liberal evangelism at all. What I do want to talk about is what I think mission is all about, and why I think it might be really important to, as it were, reboot our mind to think about what Christ, what Jesus intended in the nature of mission, and why that might matter for our churches. For those of you who may have had the misfortune to hear me speak before, just some ground rules. I always speak with my tongue firmly through my cheek, not poking through the other side. Don't believe everything I say, I don't. Secondly, we're going to take a pop at a few things, deal with some fairly serious bits of English theology. There'll be at least one poem, some discursive remarks that will have to be redacted when the recording comes out. I won't be rude about anybody, at least intentionally. And there'll be one or two things to say theologically as well, and then there'll be some stories. So as long as that sounds okay, away we go. Now, you probably think that mission and evangelism are dirty words, and surprisingly wouldn't do to a disobedient dog or a pesky puppy. And I'm not the one who said that, actually. This was said, believe it or not, by a woman called Rebecca Manley Pipple many years ago in a rather strange book called Out of the Salt Shaker. But I'm here to shock and surprise you, I think, because I want to suggest to you that mission and evangelism is something that we already do very, very well. But we just don't like talking. We don't do brash. We don't do puffery. We don't do promotion or marketing. We do self-effacement with absolutely an effort. And the reason that matters is because I think some of the understated things that we do are actually really important. But I know that they don't have a high current value in the church today. Pastoral care, connection, work with civic bodies, social bodies. These are not things that necessarily win you audit in the church today. Climbing up. They're really important because they're about socialising and they're about the busy work of being kingdom. I guess if I had one thing to say today at all, it should not be angry about the size of our church, the numerical size of our church. What we do for mission and evangelism is ask ourselves a very simple question. Don't forget that Jesus was not a habitual grower of synagogue congregation. Not a synagogue planter. He was not somebody who went around recruiting bums on pews to join ever more synagogues. He was about his father's business, about doing the work of the kingdom. That's all evangelism and mission is all about. It's about nothing else. So if you want to do mission and evangelism the Jesus way, you need to start with some decent theology of the kingdom, and you need to think about what the kingdom already looks like in the communities that we serve and seek to cherish and love. A few years ago, we crossed an unmarked line in the development of life of the Church of England. I can only think of one person who commented on this, and actually, the best-selling report ever published by the Church of England had been, up to that point, Faith in City. Those of you with a serious lack of nostalgia might remember that from 1985. We engaged seriously with pay and despair in our inner-city communities, including some extremely revealing case studies from this. Changed, amongst other things, how we viewed training of clergy, deployment of mission and ministry, and it shone a very public spotlight on our urban priority areas, champion four. The report, of course, earned the opprobrium and small right-wing press. But the serious side of this report was kind of almost unintended pun in the title. It wasn't really about faith in the city, in other words, churches, what they're doing. God theology about what cities they really work and what cities they're supposed to be. The report took seriously the fact that all the church to Jerusalem with its own needs and concerns to develop up there. Jesus Project began preaching faith, were the need for the kingdom of God. That was a clip a few years ago. By another report, came now and still is best selling for the Church of England, which is a church. Really, almost the very opposite of that. So, largely bourgeois, all niche, homogenous people, connecting together in incredible intensity, doing their thing together in ways that actually work. There are many good things about those things. In all of this thing, you have to remember that Jesus in his own kingdom ministry is only limited to do with numerical growth and growth. He's challenged the prevailing religious, social, and moral structure today. He admitted people to the kingdom of God who were not Jewish and often unconvinced. The healing miracles of Jesus. Well over 40 of them, and in nearly every case, they're visited upon somebody's name we never learn. They're so socially, morally, and religiously insignificant. They don't have to join an alpha group or a church as a result of receiving their healing ministry. Many of them, when they are Gentiles or women of local faith, are affirmed to their faith. Out of non-Jewish territory, out of Jewish territory, in Gentile territory. On several occasions, people are nothing to do with prevailing religion, social structure, and reality. And he's very partial about it too. He only heals four people in a religious building. Everything else is on the street. Four people, four women, in the God, due to their uncleanness, should not have been there. He knows what he's doing. He's in the children of order, constantly hearing other people in the faith, really rolling up his sleeves, saying, what are you going to do? Not world. I sometimes remark to other colleagues, Jesus is body language for feels the unfelt, sees the unfelt, hears the unfelt. Our mission and our evangelism, the work of the be the body. That's where you are. Who is on earth? Who is on earth? Who is on earth? What sense of our bodies matters? Inevitably, there's a bit of bad news for this church, because you're well aware of that. Church is a hub largely for people who regard themselves as honorary citizens. And the consequence of that, of course, is that we have a real sense, a keen sense, of actually who's deserving and who's undeserving, who actually should be God's grace, who doesn't really quite have the muscle. And I think it's very refreshing sometimes to go into the gospel and be reminded. I like this poem from Harry Smart called Pardon. I'm 20 years old. Apologise in advance for some of the language of the whole adult. So you'll get it. Praise be to God who pities wankers and has mercy on miserable bastards. Praise be to God who pours his blessing on reactionary warheads and racists. He knows what he's doing. The healthy have no need of a doctor. The sinless have no need of a doctor. But you say they do not deserve it. That is what when you try to wade across the estuary at low tide and misjudge the distance, the currents soft ground and are caught by the flood in deep shooks, then perhaps you will realise that God is to be praised, delivering dickheads from troubles they've made for themselves. Praise be to God who forgives sinners. Let him who is without sin cast the first headline. Let him who is without sin build the gallows, tear the noose, say farewell to the convict. Right. That's our God. God looks after the undeserving. Well, one of the things it seems to me that we've got wrong at the moment, just broadly in the church, is that we seem to be permanently stuck in marketing mode and broadcast mode. We seem to think that the only problem that we've got with the gospel is somehow tweaking the way it's presented and amplifying it a little bit larger. Like the proverbial Englishman abroad, isn't it? That we can't make ourselves understood in a world that increasingly finds us incomprehensible. Alter the vision of the track, go on an away day ideally, and come back with some fresh, rejuvenated vision of what's going on. This, of course, is a terrible theology. It's really poor. And anyone who's ever got hold of John B. Taylor's Code of God, or Donovan's Rediscovering Christianity, will understand that any decent theology, first and foremost, about reception. This what's going on around cause into marketing an exercise in business is the a recognition of the pulse of biblical tradition as spirit is on the spirit is already alive in the world. Spirit is out there beyond the church. If you want to find out what God is doing, don't assume you hold the message in the truth and broadcast it. Go and see what God is doing. Go and see how the Spirit is already at work. In other words, don't just broadcast. Get into receive a message. And of course, the church needs to do this very, very badly in all kinds of areas. sexuality, gender, equality, safeguard, the exercise of power, the holding of authority, being open to accountability. I know the church is a brilliant in these things, some of these were stuck on all the time, but of course, we're not. The world has a thing or two to say to us about justice and fairness. Has it occurred to our church that actually serious by happening from the world to the church to evangelize the church? In other words, the theology of mission and the theology of evangelism first. If we don't do that, then we will be permanently stuck in a marketing mode and a broadcasting mode in which we will just be asking ourselves, why, oh why, oh why, will people not come? Why, oh why, will not come despite our efforts at marketing and promotion with more hard selling? We're puzzled why the unwilling consumers don't buy. They don't buy, they don't listen. And I'm afraid even in business, we find that. It's in our traditions, and actually in the scriptures, there in the Old Testament, there in our great stories of saints, like Martyn, Jesus, in the beggar, there in the folk. There's something else going on here as well about the church. I think that being stuck as we are, able to work through for our own paralysis on justice, transparency, fairness. The world does not care the attention. There's a lot of allowed ourselves to get stuck on broadcasting rather than. I hail from the soft south at the moment. One of the joys of my work, as well as college and cathedral, is doing a number of things for diocese. Recently, as I may have done too, found ourselves with the unenviable task of finding a three-word strapline that summed up the characterization of our diocese. And I won't name names at this point, but we settled eventually on passionate. Contemplative and does anybody remember? Yeah. Oh, courageous, that was it, yeah. Yeah. We're not gonna recall that. Okay. I really am on message, by the way, yeah, as you can see. And we sat around as a senior staff, mulling this, and one of my senior colleagues. Area bishop who I can't name. A bit like kind of permanent anodyne, resolvable, always on the go. So, well, you know, I don't think we're very courageous. I don't think we are rational. A little bit off the line, you know. And as for compassion, well, I think the law of LGBT is better than my degree. Contemplative, we can all vote for contemplative because we're all really fed up of talking. So I just sort of sat at the back, as I tend to do wherever I go, really. And I said, look, I suggested an alternative three-word strapline. I'd like to go for Church of England. because I think it does exactly what it says on the tin. No one will have any high or low expectations as a result of those three words, really. They'll know exactly what they're going to do, really. Anyway, we've gone for courage. The bubble sometimes of self-justifying rhetoric is highly problematic for the church. And I think what we will need to do, I think, in the future is come to terms with the fact that being stuck on broadcasting mode and ever more being on ourselves just results in the public being alien. Harder. I would encourage us engage with our supernatural kind. Very good. Is not just me ripping. It's actually these old traditional theology, the kind of things you find in John B. Taylor, Vince Coffin, the sort of things that emerged out of Walter Holliday in the 1960s, the kind of things you find in the World Catholic Church, really right up until kind of post-war in the 1980s, maybe Jeff Barks earlier on, really. It strikes me, though, that requires a little bit of courage and a little bit of composition on our part. Bravery, actually. I was reminded a few years ago of some examples, really, from my own sort of field of training, where I'd come across a paradigm of evangelism. Really, very, very striking. Bear in mind, God and the Scripture, so the Holy Spirit and that, and actually the community we are already. Here's a few stories for you. I guess some of them are large, before we get there. The first one is relatively familiar territory, and it's very important. First involves a group of extremely well-meaning evangelicals, and the bought a house in the street of the they moved in and they set up part of a vampire that they were going to see them in Ordinand, being sort of impressed with their feeling of thinking to myself, I can't see how this works. And that vision folded 5 years later. Later that day, I counted two friends who actually just got in up the road. They got in an empty flat in a large block with absolutely nothing. And of course, after half an hour, around the house, and they say, well, where's your friend? Well, we're friends. Well, that's no good. I mean, Once they've got into that, because of that, they felt value. They felt hurt. Suddenly felt that actually they were two brothers who were on their side. They're coming up. They're out there. They're out there. That's what I know about theology and a mystery. Don't mind my saying, so I Exactly the same things going on with Kamara as spirits beginning the work, the ordinary work of the same thing going on up the road. God is saying, through ordinary liminal, then spirit of life work. Let me then give you two short stories. These illustrations come from Australia, in fact an individual who went to but as a parish priest, ran an entirely open baptism policy, very, very open indeed. So when people come around and say, can I have my child baptized? Yes. Great, that's a lot of Sunday. He would say, well, you don't have to make Sunday. Sunday afternoon or any other day.
Supposed to be receiving people that Christ has already touched. this is what it means, it seems to me, to have an authentic theology, missiology, and pneumatology of mission and evangelism. Stop speaking, start listening, get off the broadcast, get into reception, find out what your community wants. Because what your community wants, and what your community is telling you, is what the Spirit is saying to the church these days. And before we can evangelize, believe you me, God needs to evangelize the church. And when that's done, and we come face to face with all the things we need to do with justice, equality, and fairness, we will actually have something to say to the world. The world will have said something to us first. That's the important thing at the end of the day. Be still, learn to listen to the world around us. And if we can learn to hear the actual cares and concerns